They are skillful.
Hello, art family. And as always, thanks very much to the new subscribers. This demonstration is going to be using gouache of a neighborhood near mine called Polish Hill in Pittsburgh. And because people have asked, I wanted to mention I do sell the sketches that I do for demonstrations as well as other stuff through a store, and I'll leave a link for that in the description. So let's get started. As you've seen in other videos, I start out with a light pencil sketch. I make sure to note where my eye line is going to be so I can sort of build the drawing around that. And then as I'm drawing, I just try to take notes. I've mentioned this in other videos with cities of where things are meeting up. So say the top of one part of a building may meet up with a window on another building, or a window of one building, the bottom of a window may line up with the top of a tree. So I kind of build the drawing that way. And then I cover it all with a yellow ochre wash. I go ahead and cool down the center with some ultramarine blue, very, very light, just to make a notation of that's where all the distant hills will be. North of Pittsburgh, there's a lot of hills. It's surrounded by mountains and hills, and when you're standing on Polish Hill, on this actual hill, looking down, you can look out and see just this really beautiful industrial landscape, and then these beautiful hills off in the distance. So what I'm going to start doing is trying to establish the sky, and it was a pretty cloudy day that day, so most of this picture is going to deal mainly with local color, so there's not going to be a whole lot of stark contrast in your warms and cools, but the sky does have a stark contrast of warm and cool, where the top of the sky is a cool blue and the lower part is more yellow ochre-y. So what I did was this is something I learned from Nathan Fowkes' class on schoolism. I don't know if you've heard of that or done that, but you should definitely check it out, his landscape sketching class. But what I'm trying to do here is take some white with a little bit of blue and white with a little bit of yellow ochre for the bottom part, and just sort of rake it over the sky so that it leaves little holes where the yellow ochre will shine through. You get a kind of luminescent quality in doing that. I'm moving on to the hills. I'm just trying to get some kind of idea of what it's going to be. I know that I want to keep the saturation very, very low, and I want to use a lot of white paint to sort of push these hills back as far as I can. But for now, it's just sort of an experiment of just seeing exactly what it's going to look like and what it's going to take. So I'm going very, very heavy with the white, very low saturation, and I'm going to just start putting in these areas. And then as I increase the saturation, increase the contrast, moving closer to me, the viewer, and that'll give me a better idea of if it's working or what changes need to be made to balance it out. I'm working on this distant church, and I'm trying to keep the saturation very, very low, which I think I went a little bit too low with the saturation and lightness. I put too much white paint in it, because it didn't quite have the right pop forward that I wanted it to. But I'm keeping all of the contrast as low as possible on all the elements and the little stonework and movement of the bricks, and I'm trying to keep that contrast as low as possible because that will help sell the fact that this is further away. I'm also trying to soften those edges with wet paint just to keep it a little bit loose, and that way I can have stronger edges in the foreground, which more pronounced edges and lines in the foreground and contrasts, because that will help to push that church further back in the distance so that the buildings in the foreground and the cars in the foreground will read that they're closer. Another thing to note about that church is that the church is covered in very ornate stonework, and it's very, very beautiful. It's stunning, but I'm not really concerned with that because this sketch isn't really about how beautiful that church is specifically. This sketch is more about just the feeling of the kind of grand scheme or the grand picture you see when you're standing on the top of this hill looking out over the neighborhood. So I'm not as concerned with the detail on anything in this picture. I'm more concerned with just the broader shapes and the broader value of the entire scene, because I want to give the viewer the feeling that they're actually standing there looking at this scene, and not so much getting caught in the detail and the tiny, you know, little windows and shapes and things. Because the weather was sort of rainy at that particular time, everything is going to be more focused on the local color. One thing you might notice with my other sketches that have a prominent, strong light and a prominent, strong skylight on the other side of it, is that I deal more with the how the light is affecting the object and the shadow of that object. So on this one, I'm not so concerned with that as I am just the local color and then creating the shadow. I'm still going to have value. There's still going to be shadow in the image. Cast shadows. They're going to be a lot softer, though. They're not going to be as hard. And it's going to be more about the local color, which kind of worked when I was looking at this scene and then this image, the photograph that I took, because I like how it kind of... It's a very colorful neighborhood. It's a lot of brickwork, a lot of colorful buildings. And so when you're, you know, on a kind of rainy day where the light is more diffused, you sort of get the feeling of the... You know, the Lego bricks or the tissue boxes of color, just these columns of color. And I like that, and that was something I kind of wanted to do with this, rather than a more strongly lit scene. I'm using a 1-inch flat brush for almost the entire image. That really works well, particularly with architectural stuff. I tend to use it for everything, even if it's not architectural. I just like the feeling of chiseling out form with the edges, the corners, and drawing with it, and also just the broad strokes you can get and the nice chunky quality you can get with a big flat brush. It also forces me to not get into the details. Like right now, it would have been easy to really start focusing in on those windows and the placement, but I can't. With a brush this big, I can't focus in on that. Precise detail. It's kind of a chess game of what can I do with thick chunks of color, which I tend to really like. I like paintings that are chunky and kind of, I don't know, it's just like a personal preference of mine. Less rendered, less focused on blending the forms, and more just like what kind of, you know, fat chunks of areas of color can you get, while still giving the viewer a sense of the form, or a feeling of the form in space. Part of the chess match here, the puzzle here that I'm trying to solve, is just that it was an incredibly complicated scene. So how can I take that scene and give the viewer the feeling that they're there? Also, how do I synthesize that scene into a more simple scheme or system of colors that read clearly, that sort of telescope or look like a, you know, like you're looking through a window and the background really shoots back? And how can I do that with such a complex scene? One thing you might notice from the photograph is I cropped in to make sure that I had a nice, because if you look at the photograph, it's that photograph is even cropped from the actual photograph I took when I was there. But I was trying to get a nice strong L composition, and maybe I'll do a video on different types of compositions in the future. If you're interested in studying composition, probably the best book I have ever read, and I continue to read it over and over, is Edgar Payne's book on composition. It's called Composition of Outdoor Painting. I'm looking at it right now. It's an incredible book, but the composition I'm trying to pull off here is a nice strong L shape. So the left side of the picture is sort of a block, and then it shoots out to the side. And you still have as best I could, a balance of the image. That was part of why I didn't want the church to be too prominent, because it was closer to the center than I would like it to be in the image. So I was trying to soften it so that the real punch of the image is on those buildings on the left, so that compositionally you get this, you know, L shape that moves to the from the left to the right, and also the focal point of my perspective is going to be on the third towards the right. So it's divided into thirds, basically. I'm sure you are aware of the rule of thirds. And then where I want to draw focus is going to be through using perspective. You know, all those perspective lines are pointing to the right third of the image. It sort of draws you back into space. So at this point, I decided to take it further with a smaller brush and just start putting in some of the forms to make it readable. I could have stopped if this was in my sketchbook and I was just trying to create an image to remember the scene, remember what I was looking at. I probably would have stopped by now and just let it be what it was. But I decided to go ahead and take it further, and I kind of continued to work on it for a while. The neighborhood is covered in telephone or electric lines, so those are going to come in later. Electric lines are always handy when you're doing urban scenes, because they really kind of, they sell the depth of the scene, and they sort of place things in a space. It just really, it sells that depth. It makes things feel like they're distant, because I guess the familiarity of it or what, but it just adds a kind of, you know, a visual depth to the image. Even though it's diffuse light, I'm still trying to work in warm and cools with the shadows, and do some kind of cloud shadows to give some variation to the ground as it goes off in the distance, just some interest and variation, but very, very lightly switching from blue to orangish brown. So typically ultramarine and burnt sienna are my go-tos. But even in the shadows, I'm trying to kind of dance back and forth between those two to give some variation and some interest. By this point, I feel like the major forms are working, at least in the way that I want them to, and the distance is working. But I'm continuing to just kind of noodle away, just sort of for the fun of it. I'm also taking time to edit the image, you know, places where with the fatter brush I might have, you know, overshot the roof or, you know, left out an area. I can come back now and edit that. Since it's gouache, it's very easy to sort of layer on top. As long as you're using the appropriate amount of water, you want to go fat over lean, so what that basically means is the earlier layers that you're putting down, you want to have a lot more water in them, and then as you go, use less and less water. So if you use too much water at this point, you would pull up a lot of the layers that you've already put down. So I'm trying to use like almost no water at all, and just straight from the tube mixed and then on the paper. This, by the way, is a Crescent board, Crescent 100. I find it to be the best, I think, for gouache. I haven't really had any substrate that I've preferred over it. I mean, I've used gouache on a lot of stuff, sketchbook paper, pretty much, you know, any kind of paper anyone would suggest, I would give it a shot. But Crescent paper, you really can't, or board, it's thicker than paper, but you really can't beat it. It's nice and thick, and it absorbs just enough, and it sits on it really well, and it comes in big sheets. It's fairly cheap for being as good as it is, but I use it for illustration jobs typically, and then, you know, cut off the whatever excess I have, I cut into these little squares I can use for sketches. And it's about time for my favorite part, which is taking off the tape and getting to see what it looks like. I usually do that when I'm like 80% in, so I can get an idea of what it looks like before I, you know, do all the last details, but I went ahead and waited till the end on this one. So that's going to be it for this demonstration of Polish Hill with gouache on Crescent 100. I hope you were able to glean something out of the talk about, you know, diffuse light or whatever. I'm always here if you have questions. You can ask in the comments. And I guess I'll see you on the next video. Happy sketching. Oh, and P.S. Thank you everyone who's been so patient for the uploading of these videos. If you follow me on other social media, you know I've been inundated with illustration work. So thank you so much for your patience.